But Akers has got a big leg.
Drills it. And it's off the crossbar and through.
Wide open, man. Flipped into the end zone by Jerome Simpson. Oh, goodness.
And Westbrook stops at the one and goes down to a knee. Why would he do that? That's crazy.
All right, welcome to another edition of the MHA podcast. The draft is just days away, and we close out the preseason MHA podcast talk with some wide receiver chat. No tight ends. We didn't have enough time. We're up against it. The draft came a little bit earlier than we expected earlier in this year, so we're just going to stick to wide receivers. Tight ends aren't that fun anyway, right, Mikey? I mean, you got Gronk and a bunch of other people.
Yeah. Bunch of other crap.
Yeah, it's a lot of garbage out there. So we'll stick to the most important position, and we've already kind of talked about how important wide receivers are. I'm Eric Lansing, and it's just going to be a two-man show, as it's going to be myself and, of course, the commissioner of the league, Mikey Renaud. So no Todd, no special guests. We're doing this on a whim. We wanted to put out a show quickly, so we just kind of did it on a lark, if you will. So just a couple of three-time champions bantering back and forth. So it's pretty much what the epitome of the MHA is, right? You, me, we started it, three-time champs. It's pretty good to just kind of see what we banter off of each other.
Yeah, it's going to be awesome.
So it's going to be good, and we're glad you're joining us here. And on today's show, we'll talk shop about the wide receiver position. We'll dive into those sleepers and bust options. We'll let you know if there are any third-string wide receivers that could possibly help you out later in the draft. Of course, some rookie talk. And we'll spark some heavy debate on certain position battles that are going on. How excited are you? Just the draft, just days away, our 15th draft. It's not our 15th live draft. The first couple of years, it was just online. But the live draft, it's one of the most, I don't know, highlights of my year, I guess. I don't know for you.
Yeah, it sure is.
You might want to chew on that ice water now. It's like you're choked up. There's some emotion going into the 15th year.
Choked up. No, it's actually, it's 15 years. Wow, it's a long time. Kind of a milestone for our league.
Yeah, because, you and I were in other leagues, and leagues come, leagues go. You do it with guys in the office. Those guys leave, or you leave. And so for all these guys to kind of stick around and be here for a while, the Allens, we had Ryan on the show last time. Obviously, Aaron's been a part since the beginning. So it's always interesting. I mean, those are the fun part, and that's what it's about, right? It's just hanging out with your friends, making fun of each other, as we did with Todd on the last show.
That's right.
But just to hang out and have fun. We're going to do it at the Regency Athletic Complex. It's over a $20 million complex. We get to hang out and on a Sunday, and it should be fun. I'm excited.
I am too.
So as we get into it, before we get into all that wide receiver talk, we're going to get into some news.
An extra, extra, read all about it.
And one of the things that Kubiak came out and said is that Mark Sanchez and Trevor Siemian are co-number one quarterbacks. So, what was your thoughts when you heard that? And who do you expect, if any, Bronco quarterbacks to be drafted in our league this year?
I don't think any of the Bronco quarterbacks should be drafted. At this point, I would leave them alone. They're more matchup-based, depending on who comes out as the number one. I feel like the only reason Kubiak did that is because he kind of wants to stick it to the media. he doesn't want to give them any kind of clear-cut idea on who it is.
Why would he do that, though?
Huh?
Why would he do that?
Who doesn't like to mess with the media?
Well, maybe since he's a former backup quarterback himself, he knows how I'm sure people just wanted him to start when Elway was struggling, so he kind of understands the position of backup quarterback, or you've said it, Aaron said it, the backup quarterback's always the favorite guy.
Yeah, and you can bet that that'll be the case again. I think when it's all said and done at the end of the preseason, it'll end up being Sanchez. I know a lot of people are rooting for Trevor Siemian. Everybody wants to see what he can do. So, he'll be the favorite player. But I think Sanchez, when they play on Thursday night against Carolina, I think he'll be the guy under center.
So, out of those three quarterbacks, I mean, we talked about Siemian, Sanchez, and Paxton Lynch. He's a rookie. We're a Bronco league. We have a lot of Bronco fans. Do you think Paxton Lynch gets drafted? And should he be drafted?
No.
Due to the upside? None at all, huh?
No way. No way. You maybe draft him, like, if you were in, like, some sort of dynasty league where you were looking at having him later on in the future. But honestly, there's no reason for our league to draft him right now. He's not going to be the starter day one. So he'll be out there on free agency. If something happens and the Broncos are tanking and they decide to let him play, then if you want to pick him up then great. But, yeah, don't draft him.
Do you think we'll see him?
Do I think we'll see him?
What's your gut say?
My gut wants us to win. So my gut tells me we won't.
Okay.
There's always a chance. Injuries happen.
Going on to the second order of business here in the news department, RG3 announced the starter. Do we care? Should we care? Should we move on?
No. He plays for the Browns, so I don't really think we should care too much.
No? No.
RG3, you know, it's the same. For me, it's a prove it kind of thing. I don't think that I know I'm not going to draft him, but I don't think anybody else should either. I think he's a guy that, again, he's a matchup play. So if you find yourself kind of in a bind at some point during the season when bye weeks are going on or maybe injuries hit you, then he's a guy maybe you take a look at when he's got a solid matchup. But
really? Yeah. I don't even know if that was – I mean, they could play New Orleans tomorrow, and I'm not putting RG3 in there. Just for reference, he's going as the 29th overall quarterback at this point. I'd be interested to see. I mean, Hugh Jackson, you know, now the head coach over there, he got a lot out of Andy Dalton, you know, when he was over there. So maybe, I mean, I still think it's going to be run first then. I think he's got a nice kind of thunder and lightning over there with Isaiah Crowell and Duke Johnson. So that'll be more of the offense than maybe the Colemans of the world. And I believe Rashard Higgins is over there too, the CSU product.
Yeah,
so
Higgins.
They're really young wide receiver too. I mean, I'm trying to stay away from Browns if I can help it. But, I mean, I got Barnage ranked in there somewhere. I have Coleman ranked in there somewhere.
Josh Gordon.
We'll talk about Josh Gordon. We'll talk about him. He's definitely in the notes. I'll get your take on that. A lot of good press on DeSean Jackson. They say he seems to be 100% and is ready to have one of his best seasons ever. DeSean Jackson, one of those guys, he's a big play guy. He can get down the field. He can score some touchdowns. He can get you a punt return every now and again. I don't know if he's still doing that with the team this year. Not a big PPR guy, however. Where do you have him? What round, if you have him at all? Or what do you think about DeSean Jackson?
He's not a guy that I've ever liked to have on my team.
Ditto.
And just because he's not a big PPR guy, I mean, I took a look. He's basically, in his career, he's had one really big year. That was 2013. You know, he had over 80 catches that year, had over 1,300 yards, and had 9 touchdowns. But that's kind of the outlier in his statistics. He, more along the line, he averages, like, right around 60 catches. So I have him, like, right around the round 9 to 10 range.
Okay.
You know, he's got big playability, and he can score some touchdowns, but his targets and receptions are not, you know, large enough for me to take him anywhere earlier than that.
Does Josh Doxson hurt his value at all?
I think
first-round pick, for those who are not familiar with Josh Doxson.
Yeah, I mean, I think it absolutely could. I mean, the Redskins got, you know, a decent core wide receivers, not just Doxson, but having Garcon, also having Jameson Crowder, and then they already have Jordan Reed. So, there's a lot of options that they can go to. So, yeah, I mean, I think having him in there, that hurts his value a little bit as well.
I have DeSean Jackson 42nd on my list. You're doing rounds. I'm doing a list. I like to do lists. And so I'm not high on him, but I know at that point I'm getting some value. He's probably going to be the number one. Right, unless Doxson comes out and just blows him away, but without the PPR value, it's hard. And plus, he's had some injuries. He only played 9 games last year, so he's got that little. I mean, he's a little bit older. What is he at? Well, he's 29. So I mean, right around his prime, I guess. But I don't know. I've just never been a big fan, like you said.
I mean, and he's the number one by wide receiver definition.
Technically,
Jordan
right?
Reed is their number one target. If you want to, you know, go there. So
DeSean Jackson. So it'll be interesting to see where he goes. Sticking with some wide receiver news, Jordan Matthews won't be ready for the first 2 preseason games. He will be held out due to knee soreness. Matthews enters his 3rd year and has been fantasy relevant, having caught 16 touchdown passes in 32 games, so in his first 2 seasons. Where do you have Matthews in your rankings, and does the injury knock him down a couple notches? Or what do you think about Jordan Matthews?
Well, from everything I've heard, he's still going to be ready for the beginning of the season. I mean, he may even be ready by week three of the preseason. So that didn't really drop him too much in my rankings. I have him ranked anywhere from round 5 to 6.
Okay.
He's still going to be, I feel, the number one option for Sam Bradford.
Which is the same quarterback you played with last year, right?
Right.
So, I mean, he got 8 touchdowns from him last year.
Yeah, and then the quarterback situation there can change, too, midseason. You never know.
But he doesn't seem to, and I'm sorry if I'm cutting you off, but no one seems to like Jordan Matthews. And I don't know why that is. I don't know if it's because he hasn't had, like, he's not really consistent through his entire season. I'm trying to go through my notes here, and I'll maybe let you answer it and find it. I mean, like last year, he just had 4 100-yard games. I don't know. He doesn't seem to get a lot of love, but, I mean, he was 16th in points.
Yeah, I think it's more along the Eagles in general. I mean, the whole Chip Kelly experience over the last 2 years, I mean, it was supposed to be this, you know, quick-paced, high-powered offense that never really translated. And so, and Jordan Matthews, you never really saw him have, like, that big playability. So I think maybe he's not as sexy as a lot of these other receivers, but if you really look at the numbers, he's pretty consistent.
Yeah, he's super good. I mean, he's only 2 years, so I don't know. That's a little spectrum of what we can look at. But, I mean, for 85 catches last year, 127 targets, almost 1,000 yards, 8 touchdowns, pretty much what he did in his rookie year, too. He's 6'3". He's got the body. He's 212. He's got some speed. He was great at the end of last year, so it was a little slow. So that's probably what people remember. But, I mean, he had scored 6 touchdowns in the last 6 games. And so Doug Peterson, one thing that might scare him, I don't know, Doug Peterson offense, he's an Andy Reid disciple, as we all know. They like to run first, so I don't know if that takes some of the value away. But, I mean, if you're the number one guy and you're that, you know, you have that ability, I just feel like he's being undervalued, in my opinion, just of all the stuff I've read. I have him 23rd ahead of Michael Floyd, and I brought him down a little bit due to the injury just because, I mean, at that point I'm finicky, I'm nitpicking, really. Because injuries, you never know. You'd hope they don't linger and whatnot. And if he's 100%, I'll probably move him up a little bit. But I just feel like he's being undervalued.
Well, and to his benefit, too. I mean, really, who are the other receivers in that Philadelphia
passing?
Agreed,
yeah.
I mean, Nelson Aguilar was a complete bust.
Huge bust, I think,
last year. You know, they brought in Reuben Randle, but it's not like Reuben Randle's really ever been anything great.
Here's a quick question for you, trivia question. Who was the second leading wide receiver on that team last year, and it wasn't Aguilar.
Oh, boy.
This is how tough. I had to look this up, go down the list of the top receptions on that team.
I'm just trying to think of who else was there. I mean, I know Miles Austin was there.
Yeah, he was not it, no.
Yeah, so, yeah.
Josh Huff had 27 catches.
The old Oregon product. There
yes,
you go.
Yes, yes. So there you go on Jordan Matthews. From going to a pretty consistent receiver, we go down to an infamous wide receiver, as you already mentioned, Josh Gordon. I still have Josh Brown on my notes here. He has been reinstated for the 2016 season. He will have to miss the first 4 games of the season, however, due to suspension. He is only 25 years old. He missed the entire 2015 season with that suspension. Last played in 2014. And the thing that obviously jumps out at us is the 2013 season when he's caught 87 passes, 1,600 yards, 9 touchdowns, and only 14 games played. Should owners be interested in Josh Gordon? Are you interested in Josh Gordon?
You know, this is such a tough question. You know, ability-wise, I love him. You know, you've seen what he's been able to do in the past, but you have to be so scared to even touch him. You know, I put him at round 9.
Okay. ahead of who and behind?
And I would be scared to do that. You know,
or guys around that area. Who you think?
Guys around that area, you know, I have that would be like the same like as DeSean Jackson.
Okay.
You know, Mohamed Sanu, Michael Crabtree, Vincent Jackson, guys like in that area.
Wow, yeah, Michael Crabtree way lower than I do, my friend. Yeah, maybe we'll talk about him in this, but go ahead.
Yeah, I'm not buying last year too much.
Wow.
But yeah, with Josh Gordon, not only do you have to be worried about him getting popped for another suspension again, But I've heard he's not even really practicing yet because they're trying to get him into football shape.
Which can be difficult when it's been over a year.
Exactly. So, you know, I am extremely worried. And plus, RG3 is his quarterback now. Although that didn't seem to matter when he had, you know, other...
I was just going to say he had some pretty bad ones when he was scoring 9 touchdowns in a season.
Yeah, it's going to be one of those things where if somebody is willing to take that risk... You know,
it
can benefit him. So yeah, it'll happen.
Somebody will draft him. Someone will hate the rest of the options. And
yeah,
it was tough for me too. I have him in that same area. I have him 2 picks before DeSean Jackson, just because of the upside. But I have him like after Corey Coleman. So if I'm going to go with Cleveland wide receivers, I'd probably just take the guy who's been playing football the last few years and is practicing with the team. All right, so that's all the news there, and let's get into some MHA trivia.
Hey, hey, who wants to have some fun?
I do.
Now, are you just saying you want to have fun, or do you really want to have fun?
I really want to have fun. I'm just saying I want to have some fun.
I'm sure you think we were going to talk about wide receivers, so I don't know how much homework you did on wide receivers, but I didn't do wide receivers. Nothing jumped out at me. That's how I figure out my question. I would go through my notes, I go through my rankings, and then something like, oh, that would be a great question. None really jumped out. So we're going to do something more about the draft. If I can go through my notes here. The question is, we're in a 12-team league. And now some of the earlier leagues, we didn't have 12 teams. I think it was like 8 the first year, 6 the next year. But what position, 1 through 12, has won the most MHA titles? So is it the first pick? Is it the 12th pick? Is it in between? Which position, 1 through 12, from 2002 to 2014, or 15, excuse me, won the most positions? Do you want to think about this or you want to get this out of the way?
Hey, let's get it out of the way.
All right.
I have to think, being that me and you account for 6 of the championships, and normally our teams are pretty good, that it's not going to be anywhere from picks 1 through 6. It's got to be somewhere after that.
Okay.
But I'm not going to say all the way at the end.
Let me ask you, who Quain won last year? Do you remember where he picked last year?
No,
usually that's kind of.
But I figure he's usually pretty good too. I would figure it'd be right around 7, 8, or 9, something like that. I'm just gonna go with 8.
Okay, that is incorrect. Buzzer sound here, close. So every position has won a title except for 9th. So I really feel bad for G. He's drafting 9th this year, but we actually have a 3-way tie. 6th. It's won it twice. 1st, twice. 3rd, twice. And then everybody else once. So I have this all listed out. 2002, Crackheads drafted 6th and won the title. So that's twice. For you, in 2003, you actually drafted 3rd. So you must have had a really bad 2002 season.
I did.
I mean, it was only 8 teams. So that kind of excused things. When I drafted or won it in 2004, I drafted 1st. 2005, you drafted 1st. In 2006, I drafted 10th, and so that's kind of when through there. When Aaron won, who's standing in the kitchen right now, in 2007, he drafted 2nd. 2008, when I won it, I drafted 3rd. 2009, I've had it better. I drafted 6th. 2010, Butterfingers 12th. 2011, Lion Rip 5th. 2012, Notorious CUP 7th. 2013, Butterfingers 4th. Hot Tamales in 2014 drafted 11th, and then Notorious CUP drafted 8th. So it really doesn't matter, at least based on those numbers, except for 9th. You're screwed. G, you don't even show up to the draft. You're going to fail.
Yeah.
So there you go. Not bad, huh? I mean, it took a little time to go through it, but, you know, with the draft just a few days away, I thought that'd be good.
No, that was a really good trivia question.
That was a tough one.
More people drafting 1st than I thought would have, you know.
Yeah, those must have been some tough years for us.
Yeah.
But, you know, thinking about this now, didn't we, because I remember working with, because a lot of those college guys, like David Pollan I was in college with at the time, Quain, didn't we do a random, like, drawing of the hat as opposed to?
Yeah, I think you're right.
Because I think I remember doing a couple times where I did it with a bunch of people, like JJ, who's not in the league with us anymore. He was there. I think we picked the draft order out of a hat.
Yeah, I think you're right. I even remember one year I got creative and we had these cases of silly putty that we painted to look like footballs and they had numbers on them and we just
randomly
picked
them. So there you go. So it's not necessarily that we were bad. at that point, we just did had a different system where it's now you've pretty much where you finish is where you get drafted. So there you go, MHA trivia. Very exciting there. And so as we get back on our notes here, all right, let's get into wide receiver talks. Now, we all know who number one is, right, in terms of wide receivers. I mean, I think both you and I agree that Antonio Brown's number one. Is that easy to say?
Yeah, absolutely.
Aaron, over there, can you give me a head nod that Antonio Brown is the number one wide receiver? He's saying nah, but he means it. He thinks it's number one. So the question is not who's number one, but who's number two? Now, the guys that jump off the page are going to be Odell Beckham Jr. and Julio Jones. Who do you think should be? I mean, you're number three this year, so you'll probably take whoever's left. I mean, I get, you know, you don't want to give your strategy too much away, but who do you think should be number two in that list?
Slight edge to Beckham, and I think that slight edge goes to the fact that I think – that the Giants are going to be more of a passing team than Atlanta will be.
Okay.
So I think there'll be a lot of opportunities for Beckham to put up points with a passing game. I expect Eli Manning to have a pretty good year. And so, yeah, just slightly over Julio, but I would take Beckham.
In terms of points last year, Julio finished second with 273. Odell Beckham actually finished fifth with 240. So that's a huge difference. And obviously the thing that jumps out of the PPR numbers. For Julio Jones, 136 receptions to just 96 from Beckham. Beckham did have more touchdowns. So you're telling me that his receptions are going to get up into the hundreds and compete with Julio Jones? Because what has really changed for Julio Jones in terms of situational season for him? I mean, I guess they add, Mohamed Sanu?
I
think the targets are still going to be like he had 203 targets last year.
Right, and I don't think it's going to be anything that changes for Julio. I think what changes for Beckham. He had more of the focus of the coverage on him last year because the Giants really didn't have anything next to him.
True.
You know, he'll have the rookie Shepherd there that should be able to help him out. Victor Cruz, supposedly.
I read something that he's still not feeling 100%. I feel bad for that guy. He seems like a nice guy, just not
may or may not be healthy. So I think if there is another threat there in New York, I actually think it'll help Beckham because he won't have to worry about double coverage, you know, the entire game.
Let me ask you this. How does strength of schedule mean to you in this situation? I'm only asking that because Julio has the hardest schedule in the league. His playoffs are at L.A. You don't know what the L.A. is going to look like this year. They were pretty good a couple years ago. San Francisco, easy peasy, and then at Carolina in our championship game. You talk about Odell Beckham, the third easiest schedule, and he's got Dallas, Detroit at home, and at Philly. So that I think that even like plays your Odell Beckham, you know, number two. That just helps your argument, I think.
I think so, too. Now, Carolina, they don't have Josh Norman anymore, so that's not – I mean, that'll help Julio a little bit. But, yeah, I mean, that schedule for the Giants, yeah, he should be able to tear through all three of those teams.
Yeah, I mean, that is a playoff run if you ever wanted one for a wide receiver. So it's interesting. I mean, you're lucky to have whoever. You know, it's 2A and 2B, really, at the end of the day. I'd still want Julio just because the targets are still going to be there. I think Matt Ryan plays a little better this year. I still think they'll be playing from behind. I don't think their defense got that much better this year. So if you're asking me who I'd want out of it, I'm going to take the PPR stuff before the touchdown stuff because touchdowns could be finicky. Their running game could get a little better. Maybe Cruz comes in and does all right. You know, I hear all this talk about the tight ends playing a bigger factor for the Giants. So there's more options for touchdowns to be spread around as opposed to Julio, where it's Devonta Freeman, and if you still believe in him, and then Julio. But I mean, touchdowns fluky, PPR numbers a little bit, you know. So either way, you're going to be happy at number three.
Yeah, that's why, you know, no matter who Ryan and Robbie decide to go with, I'm okay.
Broncos wide receivers. We talked about Mark Sanchez, Trevor Siemian, Paxton Lynch. You like to boast? I'm going to boast. I'm going to boast about last year. Last year, okay? And the only reason I'm going to boast is because I did not want anything to do with the Broncos offense last year. And I remember you telling me, like, you're overthinking it. Don't overthink it. They're going to be fine. Don't worry about it. And I think I was a little right in that situation. I mean, Demaryius Thomas is all right. He didn't earn his value in the second round. Emmanuel Sanders was pretty good. He did had some really good games last year. But, like, Peyton Manning, just terrible. Like, I didn't want anything to do with him. So now we're looking at this year. Peyton's gone. You know, Kubiak can now run his system at his pace. He doesn't have to worry about Peyton coming in and changing things up. Omaha this, Omaha that. Where do you have Demarius? Let's start with Demarius Thomas. Obviously, he's a big-time name. He's done a lot of great things under Peyton. Peyton numbers. So he's going to see more. It's going to be a running game, a play-action game. Does that hurt his value? Where do you see Demarius Thomas going?
Where I see...
Wow, what was that? Ugh! Ugh!
I still think it's worth investing, you know, like a third-round pick in him.
Okay.
In Demarius. I mean, last year, his season wasn't as bad as I think people make it out to be. He had a lot of drops, which, you know, was frustrating a lot of people.
Was it what people remember, mind you, in these fantasy football leagues as well? That is what people remember.
But, you know, he still had, you know, right around 100 catches, over 1,000 yards. He just didn't have the touchdowns. Right. And so that really is why he didn't reach the second round value, which everybody had him at last year. So I don't really know. I mean, we'll get to see over the preseason and the early part of the season who Sanchez or Simeon or whoever the quarterback is, who their main receiver is going to be. I still think it'll be DT. So I think it's worth third round on him. Sanders, I had Sanders last year.
I didn't ask you about Sanders yet.
Well.
Okay. Go ahead. You know, jump in the gun with the questions.
We're talking about Bronco receivers. You know, Sanders I see more along the lines of a five or fifth or sixth round.
Okay. Let's go back to DT real quick. Who do you have in front of him and who's behind him? Because I think we're going to be I think we're off on this, and so this is a good conversation to go back and forth on.
Okay. So some people that I would have in front of him would be like Alshon Jeffrey. Somebody that I have behind him would be like Amari Cooper.
So I have him right after Keenan Allen and before T.Y. Hilton. So if guys like Amari Cooper, I mean, I have Alshon Jeffrey at 14 and Amari Cooper 12. So I probably have him more in the late fourth round, early fifth round, so not terribly different. The thing that scares me is that, and I think this is going to be the similar, because I still think Emmanuel Sanders is going to be that deep threat guy. And then I think Demarius is going to be more the mid-range, and he's going to catch those, you know, some of those crossing routes over on the sideline. Despite how terrible Peyton was last year, he still put up those big-time numbers. And I think we forgot, like, how good those numbers were. I mean, 105 catches is still pretty good.
Yeah, it's really good.
So with the yards per carry or per catch down, touchdowns down, I like some other guys with upside. If he's there in the fourth, I mean, I guess late third, early fourth. I don't know. I guess I'd have to see who's available. But I still think he'd be a pretty solid guy. For Emmanuel Sanders, do you think he puts the same type of numbers that he did last year as I look for his numbers?
Yeah, I don't see why not. I mean, he wasn't spectacular last year. He had some really, really good games.
Didn't you have him on your team?
I did have him.
Okay, okay. So, I mean, you can do a test on how good bad his season was.
Yeah, I mean, it was okay. I mean, he like I said, he had really good games, and then there was games where he would just completely disappear. And I think he probably be right around the same. I mean, he's a pretty good possession receiver. They always like to look for him on third down because he's clutch like that. That's why I love about him so much. But he again, I don't think he's going to be a big touchdown guy. So I think that's going to hurt his value.
The thing that helps his value, I mean, I have him 32nd, so right before, like, Tyler Lockett. I may have him pretty low. And after Allen Hurns and before Tyler Lockett, so around that area. But the thing that could jump his value is it is a contract year. So his money, he knows he's going to have to he's always – and I don't know these guys, but they just seem like they're hardworking guys. He wants to be here. I think he wants another contract with them. So I think he'll put up similar numbers. I think the touchdowns will drop a little bit. I think the catches will drop down a little bit just because that's not the offense anymore. And I think the tight end will get a lot more love with the Broncos now that they have Jeff Howerman comes in and does all right from his position. So, and C.J. Anderson will get some catches, I think, as well. But, I mean, they're still draftable guys. I mean, I think they're going to go early in our Bronco heavy-filled fan base.
They always do.
In that draft, in our bunch of guys. We love you guys, and we understand the Bronco world. Let's keep going here to a team that has a more of a pass-first offense. In the Arizona Cardinals,
They have three really talented wide receivers over there. And just all over the spectrum of me listening to podcasts, reading fantasy magazines on the line, in terms of who goes first is the most interesting conversation, I think, of any battle position anywhere. You have Michael Floyd, who's more of the prototypical guy, 6'3". You know, he's got really good hands. He seems like he's built for that superstar status. But then you have Larry Fitzgerald, who's the old-timer. He helped me win a championship many moons ago, and it has been many moons since I won a championship. But, you know, I had him in his prime. But he's still out there. He had 9 touchdowns last year, over 100 receptions, if I'm not mistaken. Mm-hmm. And then Josh Brown. Is it Josh Brown? John Brown.
John Brown.
who is Todd's favorite guy, is being the third wide receiver. But he has a lot of value as well. Who were you drafting first out of that bunch?
I have Michael Floyd.
Okay, all right.
There's no doubting that he's their guy that they kind of look to when they do those fade patterns in the red zone. The reason I have him over Fitzgerald, who I have second out of that bunch, is because there was a clear statistic when David Johnson was starting to get the carries full-time, Larry Fitzgerald's numbers started to drop. Most of Larry Fitzgerald's big-time numbers were at the beginning part of the season. And so, and he's getting older, so I see those numbers going down even further, you know, than they were in the second half of last year. John Brown, he was a tough one for me because he's probably their best big play threat, but I don't see the consistent receptions coming out of him.
Yep.
So I had to put him as the third option, but it's... They're all pretty close. I mean, I have Michael Floyd in the 5th round, Larry Fitzgerald in the 6th round, John Brown in the 7th round. So they're all pretty close.
Yeah, and I agree with you. This isn't a good show. We're agreeing. We're supposed to be hating, disagreeing. I mean, when we're just sitting here talking, we seem to disagree. But I'm with you. Michael Floyd's also in a contract year, which is going to be huge for him. And he just saw Fitzgerald get an extra year. He saw Carson Palmer get an extra year. I'm not sure how long Brown is there for a while. So he's got a lot to live up to. He's relatively healthy, 16, 16, 16, and 15 in his career. I will say that he has just 19 touchdowns in 4 years. So while he has the body, he's got the hands. I think in one of my leagues I drafted him expecting him to have a better year. I mean, he only had, out of all the receivers, I think he had the least amount in terms of fantasy points, 52 receptions, 849 yards, 6 touchdowns. I expected more from him last year.
I think so. But I think that'll go up this year. I think that the connection between him and Carson Palmer got better towards the end of the year. I can distinctly remember when they played Seattle in Seattle towards the end of the year. He had a great game against Richard Sherman. He was just jumping over him and catching passes. So, yeah, like you said, he has the frame, and he's still young. So, yeah, I mean, I can see his numbers getting better.
I have Fitzgerald 28th, right in front of John Brown. So I'd be willing to take either one of them. You mentioned Fitzgerald, a slow end of the season, just 2 touchdowns in the last 8 games, although he had a pretty good playoff, if I remember.
Oh, he had a great
playoff. Right? So, I mean, but he knows that he's getting at the end of his career. He really wants that championship. But, you know, with John Brown, he's seen 103 targets and 101 targets in his first 2 years. That's how much this team throws the ball. As much as he loved David Johnson, I love David Johnson, this team's still going to throw the ball a ton. He had 1,000 yards in those limited 65 catches in his sophomore campaign. He was actually 24th in points. Larry Fitzgerald, 7th in points.
Yeah, oh, that's incredible.
How good was he in the first part of the season? He had 6 touchdowns in the first 8 games, and he averaged 7 catches per game. Like, in our league, that is money. And unfortunately, he didn't. And then I don't think he was ever dropped, but I think there was conversations of people dropping him near the end of the year, which is crazy to say. But I think just it's amazing, like, we're talking about the Broncos and how we have, I don't want to say low, but, I mean, just we're worried about the run production. But this team has David Johnson, Ellington, who, if you can say healthy, is pretty solid. Chris Johnson comes back. He's not going to be 100%. But we're talking about 3 guys splitting the targets, in essence.
Well, and they like J.J. Nelson, too.
So yeah, he's always in that conversation. So, interesting to see where those 3 guys go. We're both, I think, on the same page and who we think has got the best value in terms of Michael Floyd at the top. Some more wide receiver battles, the Jacksonville Jaguars and what they did last year with Allen Robinson and Allen Hurns. Blake Bortles
had a breakout season for him, getting those two involved. I'll say about John Brown, suffered a concussion just a few days ago. So he said they might not play in the first preseason game. So that's something to think about. Usually concussions subside, but in this world and of TV and movies and, you know, no one's going to take a chances. So that's I'm just throwing it out there, just doing my homework. I noticed that. So back to Jacksonville and what they did last year. Allen Robinson obviously helped Quain win a championship. He was phenomenal. Allen Hurns had double-digit touchdowns. Do you feel the same way that they're going to produce the same type of numbers, or is it going to be more – it's a regression just because many reasons, whether they got better defensively, so not playing from behind as much. Blake Bortles takes a step back. What do you see happening with that wide receiver situation over there?
It's got to be at least a little bit of regression. I mean, the team is better. They have Chris Ivory now, so I would figure that he would, you know, kind of be the guy that they would use when they're inside the 10. So they may not have to throw as much. If Julius Thomas is healthy, that may take a little bit away from them as well.
Yeah, and he was a little bit better at the end of the last season too, I remember.
Yeah, so a little bit of regression, but I think that those two still have the ability to put up some pretty big numbers. And I think that Allen Robinson, because of his performance last year, he's still going to be one of those guys that's like right at the end of the round one, early round two. That's where he's going to go.
Okay. I love how you put that. That's where he's going to go. Is that where he should go? Where do you have him in your rankings?
Well, that is right around where I have him.
You're talking top six, seven in terms of, I mean, I guess it depends on how many wide receivers think are going in the first round.
Yeah, I think there could be a six or seven that do.
Wow, okay. I have him 10th. Yeah. So I guess depending on where you have him and ranked behind, I mean, it's tough going through those guys, and I can't believe I have Jordy Nelson and Dez Bryant over him. And that could change depending on how they do. And Jordy's already dealing with a setback. Dez Bryant, who knows with the – I mean, I don't know. I guess I'm super concerned. Kind of the same thing that you mentioned. Chris Ivory's there is going to steal some touches away. There's so many mouths to feed over there. You know how many times I've heard podcasts about Rashad Green and who's the other guy? Lee, I believe, from USC, if I'm not mistaken. Like, those guys are getting a lot of pub as well. And so there is just so much competition over there. Is he one of those guys that is an elite talent? It's going to do well no matter what. I don't know if we know that yet. I mean, his numbers obviously with 80 catches, 1,400 yards, and 14 touchdowns, and 17.5 yards per catch is incredible. So it seems like he's still young. He's only entering his third year, so he could even get better depending on if you believe in the third year wide receiver growth. But I don't know. I mean, for other guys like I have Mike Evans ahead of him. He's got less competition. Yep. He's got a quarterback that's getting a little bit better. Not that I think that Bortles is not or that Winston is on the same level as Bortles, I guess, just because I'm more of a pocket passing type of guy that I prefer than a guy that's going to run around and get touchdowns. But, I mean, just the targets alone, I think he had 153 targets, and what he did with those targets are phenomenal.
Absolutely.
So I don't know if he could do that again with those same target. Now, if he was getting 200 like Julio, then he would shoot up my rankings. But there's just too many people over there, isn't there?
There is. There's a lot of people over there, and that's why I think, yeah, there will definitely be regression in those numbers. But I don't think it's going to be a lot. I don't think it will.
Give me what do you think his numbers might be? And I know this is off the top of your head, but what do you see him
justify?
I mean, you're talking first round. So if we're talking about the end of the first round and it's Gronk and Allen Robinson – Gronk, 85 catches, 1,200, 13 yards, 50, depending on where you like Gronk, 10 to 12 touchdowns. Allen Robinson, you figure going to be not as good as last year. So PPR numbers are lower. His yards are going to be lower. His touchdowns are going to be lower. So I feel like that's why Robinson should be kind of in that second part, early part of the second round, depending on everybody has their draft strategies. But I don't know. I feel like you have him a little bit too high. But give me his numbers. I
still think he's going to be close to, like 80 receptions. He'll be over 1,000 yards. And I don't think he's going to hit that 14 touchdowns, but maybe he's a little bit less. Maybe he's like around 10.
Okay.
He's still going to be a really, really good receiver.
Give me your thoughts on Allen Hurns. He's definitely been a guy of discussion. Can he duplicate his 10 touchdowns? I mean, is it the same conversation? Is too many mouths to feed? Was it an aberration? Now, for Allen Hurns, he's 6'3".
You know, he was 17th in points last year. He's entering his third year. 64 catches on 104 targets, 1,000 yards, 10 touchdowns. He has a really good yard per catch as well. It's 16.1. So he also had 6 touchdowns in his 2014 campaign and 97 targets. So, I mean, he's got the ability. But, I mean, as a number two, you know, Chris Ivory, I know I can't remember. I think Allen Hurns, most of his touchdowns came outside the 10. You know, they like to throw a little – we saw a lot of deep touchdowns from him. Where do you have him, I guess, in your rankings? And do you think he can kind of duplicate what he did last year?
Yeah, him I'm not as high on. I have I have him in round 7.
Okay.
And so, I mean, 60-something receptions where he was at. He's the deep play guy. I don't see him – if there's regression, he's going to be like right around 55 catches and – you know, maybe close to 1,000 yards. I don't know that he hits that double-digit touchdowns, though.
Let me ask you this, half serious, half joking. It's the Jaguars, right?
Right.
I mean, not since they beat us in the playoff, the Broncos, were they really good? There's a lot of talk that Jacksonville's defense is going to be better. What are the chances of them not being better? And Bortles having to throw 600 times as he did last year. I mean, they got some good players, no doubt about it. But there's a chance they may not work. Either. I mean, we were like, oh, Miami, Ndamukong Suh. Whoa, yeah, it's going to be great. No. And so maybe there's this chance that they're not as good defensively and they have to throw. They're playing from behind again. I mean, Andrew Luck's back, right?
Yeah.
So there could be a chance that Bortles has to throw 600 times and that's going to lift Allen Hurns. We're going to lift Allen Robinson and his 15 touchdowns again. Am I stupid for thinking that?
No, I'm not going to say you're stupid for thinking that. It's always a possibility, but I think at least at the beginning of the season, they're going to at least try and do it by trying to run the football, trying to get that part of their game more involved. So I think at least at the beginning of the year, they'll try it. If it doesn't work and they're still losing, and they're going to go back to their old ways and throw. But so I don't think you're stupid on that.
Thank you. You usually call me stupid.
Yeah. Well, we still have a long show. So.
Yeah, we got some stuff to talk about.
Give me something I can use.
We'll talk about Michael Crabtree in a little bit. Steeler time now. Okay, Antonio Brown, we've got that out the window. He's the number one wide receiver, but who is number two? We obviously know Martavis Bryant's out for the year because he likes his drugs as well. Now the guys end up becoming, well, I mean, Marcus Wheaton is the guy that jumps out at you first, right? I mean, he played a lot last year. He may not have been otherworldly, but, I mean, he was productive. But all I hear about is Sammy Coates. Sammy Coates this, Sammy Coates that. Who are you drafting as a number two? And are you excited, or are you staying away from number two over there?
Well, I am taking Coates before Wheaton.
Okay. Tell me why.
Here's the reason why. I think if you're looking for the receiver to take in that offense, you want the guy who's going to take the actual position of Martavis Bryant. And Martavis Bryant was that big play, you know, big, deep threat guy that was scoring the touchdowns. And I think that Sammy Coates more fits that profile. They tried playing Marcus Wheaton last year, and he was okay. He wasn't, you know, great. He's going to be on the field, but I don't think that he's offers any sort of upside as far as big playability. When they look through intermediate stuff, they're going to be going to Antonio Brown first, probably Ladarius Green second. So if they're going deep, then I see them going to Sammy Coates.
But Sammy Coates is like, what does it say here, 6'2". So he's not really that typical 5'10 speedster that's going to run up and down the field and throwing over the top. I mean, for Marcus Wheaton, he's 5'11", so he's not – I mean, I'm not sure how fast Marcus Wheaton is. I don't know if he's that type of guy. But, I mean, if you get another prototypical type wide receiver who's been making – all this splash, I guess he'd be more of like a possession receiver. I mean, I don't know. I mean, he didn't play that much in his first year. He only played in 6 games, 1 catch. So I'm still learning the system, I'm assuming, at that point. Coaches didn't like what they saw from him. But Marcus Wheaton had 44 catches and 5 touchdowns. Now, a lot of that's Big Ben because he's that good. Okay, and Le'Veon Bell's out. That's going to help him as well. So I guess if you're looking for safe at point of the draft, do you go Wheaton over Coates? Or do you like Coates no matter what and you think he's going to put up the best numbers? Either way.
Wheaton is probably, if you're going to go the safe route, Wheaton's probably the way to go. But if you're looking for upside, which I think is what you are looking for that deep in the draft, then I would go Coach.
I don't know. I guess if he's my fifth or sixth wide receiver,
I don't know. I feel like, I don't watch enough Steelers training camp, I guess, to know really what's going on. But for a guy who's been in the Pittsburgh system, he's going in his fourth year, at least on my sheet, in terms of fourth year with the Steelers. I mean, that's a lot of experience to be with Big Ben. You have that chemistry. I guess the thing you could say about him is that, well, in those three years that I have in front of me, he's never really done too much. Like, he had 53 catches in 16 games, 44 catches in 16 games last year. But I guess his window or his ceiling is limited. Like, you don't figure he's going to come out and bust 80 catches for 10 touchdowns. Yeah. But I don't know. I mean, I guess we'll have to wait and see. And that's going to be tough for our draft because we can't wait and see. You know, we're going to be – you know, I think both of them get drafted. I honestly do. I think, yeah, I mean
– I agree.
I think if we have people that bring new – you know, we bring our magazines to the draft, but we have our lists. We've done our homework. There'll be some owners that just bring their magazine or steal mine and then go through and say, oh, Marcus Wheaton's number two. He might go before Coates. And so I don't know. I think it's split. If I had to guess what the league thinks about it, I'm split, honestly. Looking at my rankings, I do have Coates 45th and Wheaton 49th. So from what I've seen and heard, but that's all I can do at this point is what I've seen and heard because I'm not seeing it personally. All I know is Wheaton's been in the system and Coates has struggled in the six games he played. But
you saw Coates. He had a couple big plays in the playoff game against Denver last year.
Okay.
And so I saw a little bit there. Wheaton, I just feel like he's one of those guys where you're going to be sitting watching the TV and you're like, four catches, 35 yards. Oh, okay. Great.
Yeah, that's tough to have those. Tough to watch those guys not do much on your team, especially as a number two. I mean, but at the end of all of it, he could be number three. Or if he ends up being the slot guy, and 6'2", Sammy Coates is on the other side, outside Antonio Brown. But, I mean, I have him in the 40s, like mid to late 40s. So it's something I hope I don't have to deal with. But, I mean, if I'm in the 16th round, you know, 15th round, our draft, what, 17 rounds, and I'm usually waiting super late on a defense and a kicker, so in the 16th round, I'll probably take a flyer on either one, depending on how it goes. So we'll see. I mean, they're going to throw a lot, I think, with Le'Veon Bell out. I'm still hearing rumblings that it could be reduced to three or maybe even two games for Le'Veon Bell. It's going to be interesting to see where he goes in our draft.
It's going to be very
interesting. That is going to be so interesting. Either this guy's going to look like a genius or a total maroon, and it's going to be G. Well, it's going to be G because he's number nine and he's screwed. He's drafting ninth. He's going to pick Le'Veon Bell and Amari Cooper. They're both going to suck. Poor G. We feel bad for you, G, but we love you. All right, continuing on here, and this is what I kind of alluded to earlier, but Doug Baldwin. Interesting case. Now, there's some days, and I'm not going to lie, some days I love him. I mean, just like listening to the podcast and, again, reading, watching television, NFL Network, and big shout-out to Kevin. He's working at the NFL Network. We love you. We know you're doing great things over there. But some days I love Doug Baldwin, and then some days, oh, I'm going to lower him on my rankings because, I mean, I don't think anybody really thinks he's going to pull off those 14 touchdowns again, but I still think he could – this is Eric loving Doug Baldwin today. I think he still could get 80 catches and 10 touchdowns.
Yeah.
Am I crazy?
Maybe a little. here's what I did with him.
Okay.
The hype has Doug Baldwin, like, in round three or four. My gut has him in round six or seven. So I kind of went in between.
So
and I just put him
at
fifth.
Same page. You like him 7 days and don't hate him. Okay.
Yeah, so
put him in the middle. You compromise.
I slotted him right in the fifth round, a decent enough compromise. Because for me, it was so weird. He wasn't even on anybody's team. So he wasn't on anybody's radar. And then all of a sudden, midway through the season, he just busted out and was one of the great receivers for the rest of the year. So, you know, I don't know how much of that was just, you know, Seattle's offense was just being on fire, or whether or not this is a, you know, fact, and he's just going to come out and be a gangbusters this year.
Who do you have in front, and who do you have behind him, around?
I have him right around the Jordan Matthews. I have him, like, in front of Larry Fitzgerald, in front of guys like Dante Moncrief, Julian Edelman. Guys like that.
Gosh, we are right on the same page. This is eerie. I'm really scared right now. I have him right in front of Moncrief and Larry Fitzgerald, and I have him after Matthews and Eric Decker.
Yeah,
and
that's the other guy I have, Decker.
That's amazing. And I'll throw out some stats. Last year he finished ninth in points, obviously with those 14 touchdowns really late in the season. the competition isn't great, which is why I love him some days. I mean, you have Lockett. If you really like Lockett, I'm okay with Lockett. I don't think he's going to usurp him as the number one wide receiver. But Jimmy Graham, give me a break. I mean, what's it going to take for people to stop believing? Before you came over, I was watching NFL Network, like, oh, Jimmy Graham, he's going to come back and he's going to be, no, it's done. He's done with him. So the competition isn't there for him either. Like, so that doesn't scare me. Obviously, we talk about the fantastic second half, 47 catches, 724 yards, which was, and all those touchdowns. And that was at the same time Jimmy Graham went down. So that coincides with one another. Does that, with him back, does that, I don't know. I guess it depends. I think the biggest question throughout this whole Seattle thing is, do you feel like they're going to go back to the running ways? Or are they going to pass like they did at the second half of the season? Now, Russell Wilson is capable to throw 500 times, throw for 30 touchdowns. He's probably going to run for five, so maybe that diminishes his passing touchdowns. But do you think, from what you've seen, are they going to go back to the running game? Obviously, they don't have Marshawn Lynch. He's gone. For those who don't know by this point, Thomas Rawls seems pretty competent in that position. They have ProSize. They have Kristen Michael. They have a bunch of guys. What do you think? Are they going to be the passing team or the running team this year?
Somewhere in between. I think they'll be more of a passing team than they've been in the past because Russell Wilson has shown that he can do that now. So he's at the point where I don't think that they have any fear of Russell Wilson just going out there and chucking it.
You know, okay.
He's proven at this point he can go out there and get the job done. You know, plus they have Tyler Lockett on the other side too, which I think only helps their offense. I agree with you on the Jimmy Graham thing. It's
sorry, Jimmy Graham.
Yeah.
You were with us for a couple of years. We appreciate it. Now, here's some things that really scared me and scares me about Doug Baldwin. He had just 104 targets, which is not elite by any stretch. We said elite was 203 by Julio Jones. Those next level guys are in the 150s. So unless you think that they're going to throw even more and get 150 targets, because that's where if I knew Doug Baldwin was getting 150 targets, I'd shoot him up my list.
But that's the thing. Like I said, he didn't start like really coming on until about midpoint in the year. So I think if they were, you know, chucking the ball around from the week
from the
one, his targets probably would have been a lot more. They were playing the normal Seattle ball at the beginning until Lynch got hurt.
And Jimmy Graham went down, yeah. And so they kind of had to. Baldwin, 14 touchdowns last year, 15 in the previous four seasons combined.
That's why I'm scared.
Touchdowns are fluky. The targets aren't high. But if they pass the ball, he's the number one guy, in my opinion, by far.
Yep.
By far. And Russell Wilson, I have him pretty high on my quarterbacks list. I think he's like fourth or fifth for me. So I must believe that he can throw the ball. He will throw the ball. And so Doug Baldwin's, I have him 26th. Like for a guy that, I don't think he's going to, I would say 70 catches, 1,000 yards, and probably more like the 7 or 8. So that's not up there with the top guys. But he's not 26th either. So I don't know. I'm all over the place. I hate him and I love him at the same time.
I just know I'm going to have that situation on draft day where I'm just like back and forth. My pick's coming up and I'm just like,
someone please
Doug
draft
Baldwin,
him.
Eric Decker, Doug Baldwin, Eric Decker. And then I'm going to say, oh, Eric Decker.
You know, let's talk about Eric Decker. We talked about him a little bit on the previous show when we were talking about Brandon Marshall and Fitzpatrick coming back, whatever. He's another one of those guys. I was surprised to have him this high, but he's been pretty consistent in terms of what he's been able to produce. He's had 10 or more touchdowns in three of the last 4 years, 13, 11, 5 because he was injured, and then 12. Like, I don't think he gets enough love. And, I almost don't want to talk about him because I want to draft him, and I don't want anybody to steal him from me. But he's been pretty good. Even Ryan Fitzpatrick is back. Even with Brandon Marshall stealing all those targets on the other side, he still had 131 targets.
Yeah, and I think a couple weeks ago looked up that crazy stat that he pretty much in the red zone last
yes.
year had more targets than anyone
And Chris
else.
Ivory's gone.
Yeah.
I mean, Matt Forte is going to steal some receptions, but you and I know that he was terrible inside the one. I had Matt Forte. Now, he's a great catch. He can catch the ball in the backfield. He can run the ball in between the 20s, but inside the 10, he was terrible. Terrible. So I think that's just going to make Deckard and Brandon Marshall that much better. Because I don't know who the tight end is. Jason Morrow, who cares? He sucks.
Yeah.
But, man, that's going to be phenomenal. Whoever gets him is going to be I hope I'm the one. I hope you MHA owners stay away from Eric Decker. But I'd be happy to have him as my number three guy.
Yeah, you know,
maybe two, but depending on what I do. But
you know, they're going to they always run that little slant pattern inside the
and
10.
And you can't stop it.
You can't stop it. Stop. He's always ends up open somehow.
So that's some quick Eric Decker talk. I love that. I love Derek. I mean, I was up late cramming. Like, we didn't have a lot of time to do a lot of homework because, you know, we have to work and, you know, everything's going on. And so I had to cram, and I was like, Eric Decker, like me some Eric Decker. As pompous as he seems to be, I want him on my fantasy team. Okay, continuing to go here, another guy that could have owners confused is Golden Tate. Calvin Johnson's gone. PPR machine. Still feel like he doesn't get a lot of value in our league, or people don't appreciate him. What are your thoughts? Where do you have Golden Tate?
Love me some Golden Tate.
Oh, he loves him some Golden Tate.
Love
All
him
right.
some Golden Tate. I have him in third round.
Ooh. All right.
Yeah, I just think that he's gonna be one of those guys that easily eclipses 150 targets this year.
All right. Well, give me a couple guys that are near him for you.
I actually have him right near Jordy Nelson.
Oh my gosh. So you must be really low on Jordy Nelson.
No, you know, I have Jordy Nelson right around the, you know, end second, you know, early third. But okay. I have Golden Tate right around there too.
Wow, that is incredible. I have him 21st behind Jeremy Maclin and ahead of Jarvis Landry. So I have him a little bit lower.
Yeah, you do.
For sure. You know, some of the things I'll throw out there and you can chime in too. So he finished 21st in points last year. He had 90 touchdowns. Excuse me. Yeah, 90 touchdowns. He'd probably be number one. 90 receptions. Hey, Cat. I have to yell at the cat. He's over here playing with cords. 90 catches, 128 targets, 813 yards, and 6 touchdowns. Now, that was with Calvin Johnson in the lineup. He's been relatively durable. 15 or 16 games played in 5 of 6 years. Targets are going to go way up. He's had 90-plus catches of the last 2 years, 142 targets, 128 targets. But the thing that's scary, if you're not sure about Golden Tate, or he's only has 25 touchdowns total in his career. Total. He enters his 7th year this year. So that's not a ton. That's not an elite guy. The last thing, and I'll let you chime in here, just 9 yards per catch last year, which was the lowest by far in his career. Now, that's with Calvin Johnson, but I think he makes more of his money in those short routes like we see with Edelman, where they're quick outs, and then he's going to go down to avoid getting hurt for him being in his 7th year. So, I don't know. I see the PPR there, but I think the super lack of touchdowns, and they may go up. I don't know.
He's going to have over 100 catches. You just watch. If he's healthy, he's going to.
But is that enough? I mean, he had 90 catches for 813 yards.
Yeah.
So on a typical day, what is that? 5-6 catches for 60 or 70 yards?
Well, and I think it's without
not Jordy Nelson numbers, I would
without
think.
Without Calvin Johnson, I can see his yards per catch going up. I think he won't be necessarily just running those little short routes. A little research I popped up on. 2 years ago, when Calvin Johnson was hurt for 3 or 4 weeks, Golden Tate averaged 15 targets a game.
That's a ton.
They're going to be looking at him. I mean, who else are they going to look at in the red zone?
Well, I was just going to go through the depth chart of their wide receivers, and I guess you don't like the Marvin Jones or Anquan Boldin. Pettigrew.
I can't believe you mentioned that one. But
I have to. He's a top-ranked tight end. I guess Eric Ebron, but he's hurt.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I could see. I mean, Theo Riddick had 70 catches last year, and he did nothing with 70 catches, by the way, other than have 70 points off catches, but he didn't do any rushing either. So he takes some of them away. So I could see your point. I could see Golden Tate getting a ton of targets. But, I mean, 128 targets, so are we talking – 30 more targets? Are we talking 200 targets like the Julio Joneses of the world? I mean, the running back situation, unless you believe in Amir Abdullah, probably going to be throwing a ton.
Yeah, I think
the defense is not going to be good, so they're going to be throwing a ton that way too.
Yeah, I think they're definitely going to be throwing a ton. I think you could see Golden Tate close to 170 targets, to be honest.
Well, I think that would get him over I hope that would get him over 1,000 yards.
I think so.
And that should bring his touchdown total up a little bit as well. So, I don't know. I guess we're a little split. All right, another guy who I believe, I don't know. I'm kind of a mixed bag on Jarvis Landry, the wide receiver over in Miami. Now, I will be totally honest.
I didn't have him last. I didn't have him in any league last year, and I was pretty surprised that he had over 100 catches last year, despite Ryan Tannehill and that offense and just the ineffectiveness of that offense. The dudes get targets. I mean, what do you think about Jarvis Landry? And where do you have him going?
I see him as a late third, early fourth round guy.
Okay.
Because again, he's going to get a ton of targets. He's another guy that's probably going to end up close to or over 100 receptions. They also use him a lot on reverses. He does a little bit of stuff in the special teams game too. So he's got some big playability there. You worry about the touchdown number on him. He didn't really have a lot of those, but he's still young. I think that can go up. So, yeah, I mean, late third, early fourth, I think that's a good spot for him.
I have him at this point right after Golden Tate. So I guess this shows I'm not a big fan or I just am not appreciating him, which I could be totally right on. I'll take Stafford over Tannehill any day. So that kind of played into my factor. He played in 16 games last year. He played in 16 games his rookie year, so he seems pretty durable. 165 targets, 110 receptions. And he did that in 165 targets. That's really good numbers. And he had, and I'm surprised I don't have Golden Tate behind him, but he did have over 1,000 yards, 10.5 yards per catch. So a little on the low side that way. And obviously the four touchdowns are pretty low too. I don't have anything. I didn't get to do a lot of research on him. Obviously with Tannehill, the other options on his team aren't stellar. Lamar Miller leaving.
Yeah.
Only helps that situation unless you think Arian Foch is going to play 16 games, which none of us, I think, believe are going to happen.
No, I don't think that's going to happen. A lot of people are very high on Devontae Parker, though.
Yeah, and I didn't get that out there. Conversation. Like, I had him super low. I mean, in this magazine, he's 37th compared to Landry's 25th, so I have him relatively low. I don't know what number I have him at, but I don't see what the big fuss is about Devontae Parker. Other than I think he's got the prototypical body at 6'3", 209 pounds, and he's relatively young. But, in 14 games, just 26 receptions. Now, he's a rookie, so you give him a pass in that regards. But I don't know. I mean, just 52% target success, which isn't a great number. I mean, you can go back to the rookie situation there. But, I mean, I have him 34th, so I have him better than the magazine, so I guess maybe I'm just running out of guys I like at this point. But he's already dealing with a hamstring injury, and he left last year early due to a foot injury. So you hope that ends. You know, you don't want to see that. I want to see the Dolphins be better. I just don't see it. I don't like the defense. I don't like Arian Foster. I'm trying to like Jay Ajayi, and that's just because on that full team keeper, I have him as one of my running backs. Hopefully, I don't have to start him. But I don't know. I'm just not a big fan of the Dolphins, what they look like this year.
The analysts want you to buy into the Adam Gase quarterback guru thing.
Yeah, and doesn't he do a good job with wide receivers?
He does.
I mean, Alshon Jeffrey was a beast when he was healthy.
Yeah.
I'm not going to give him too much credit with the Peyton Manning stuff. Peyton Manning is Peyton Manning. He's a certified Hall of Famer. He can make me and you look like Emmanuel Sanders and Demaryius Thomas. I think that's how good Peyton Manning is with those guys. But I guess the only thing that we could say for Tannehill, I think he's in the hot seat, so I think he'll have to put up better numbers. I don't think he's a guy that's slacking by any stretch and trying. I mean, just from what we've seen on Hard Knocks, or you know, listen, he says all the right things on TV. But if their defense is going to be bad, they're going to have to throw, right?
That's right.
So I guess Devontae Parker, along with Mr. Landry, are going to get some targets. But will they turn into touchdowns? Are they just going to be fighting inside the 20s? And when they get to the end zone, nothing happens? I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, I can't.
I hope I don't have to I'll pick Landry based on his PPR stuff. Like, if you tell him he gets 100 catches, you have to have him on your team. But I don't know if I'm going to go with Parker. But I guess it depends.
Yeah, it's just all how the draft plays out. You won't reach on him, but I guess if he's there where you're comfortable, then you go for it.
All right, so we were mentioning what Parker did in his rookie year. Let's talk about some rookies. I gave you a small list, and if there's someone off the list, you can definitely tell me if there's a guy you like. The ones I sent you were Corey Coleman, Sterling Shepard, Laquan Treadwell. And I think those are the only ones I really sent to you off the top of my head. But, I mean, there's so many rookies, wide receiver rookies out there. Are you interested? I mean, they always go. At some point in the draft, you're like if I'm looking through my wide receiver list now, and let's see where I put my first rookie wide receiver. I have him 37th
right after Michael Crabtree. So maybe I didn't have Michael Crabtree as high as I thought I did. I thought I really liked him. So I have Michael Crabtree, and then I have Sterling Shepard, Corey Coleman, Kamar Aiken. So, like, the upside is gone for, like, the guys who you know are number ones or twos or something like that. So you're like, well, you know, Sterling Shepard's going to play with Eli. He's supposed to have this great year. Corey Coleman, he's the number one guy. If RG3 is anything competent, any wide receivers did you like or thinking about drafting?
Well, and I cheated a little bit here.
You bastard, how could you? This is a cheat-free zone, a Tom Brady-free zone, and you're funking it up.
Well, look, Kevin White didn't play last year. So he basically is a rookie.
So he's a rookie. Okay, fine. I almost thought about putting him on, but okay, go ahead. Mr. Smart Guy over here with your Kevin White. Go ahead.
So, yeah, I mean, Kevin White's going to slide into that second wide receiver with the Bears, another team who's probably going to be throwing a lot. And we've seen in the past what that second wide receiver for Chicago is able to do, is able to put up pretty big numbers. And I've liked what I've heard from so far in camp from Kevin White. So I think I have him ahead of Chad Coleman. Chad Coleman's Corey Coleman is the other guy that, you know, I have up there high along with Sterling Shepard. So those three are kind of my three rookies that I'm probably going to be taking a look at.
Kevin White, huh?
Yeah.
I guess, I mean, are you that confident? I mean, you've seen John Fox offenses. You've seen him with John Elway.
Yeah.
Cutler's not LA. Not that I'm trying to compare him. But if you're talking about, I guess it depends on how much you believe in Alshon Jeffrey and what he's going to get and then what Kevin White's going to get in this offense at the same time. Now, Martellus Bennett is gone. I guess it depends on how much you believe in who's their tight end over there. Zach Miller?
Not a lot.
Jeremy Langford? I don't think he's a big PPR guy. Not visible in PPR, but he's not Matt Forte. So I don't know. I guess if you're looking at the Chicago offense as a whole, I guess you have to figure how many targets you expect to get out of those top two receivers.
Well, and it's more so that I think Chicago is going to be losing a lot in the games. I think John Fox wants to be able to run the football, but I don't think they're going to be able to commit to that because I don't believe in Jeremy Langford. They're playing in a division where Minnesota is a tough team, Green Bay is a tough team. You know, Detroit likes to score some points. So I think it's more that they're going to have to throw to try and keep up with these teams. And so I think that Kevin White has to get some of those targets.
One of the – we talked about Laquon Treadwell, phenomenal college guy. Read yesterday, and I hate giving away these tidbits to the rest of you owners out there, but he's currently fifth on the depth chart of the Vikings. Of the Vikings. Yeah. You know who the number one receiver is? Go ahead and say it. You know who it is.
Stephon Diggs.
Stephon Diggs is your number one wide receiver, and he's been getting good press. I've heard a lot of good things this past week about Stephon Diggs, but Treadwell is fifth. I can't even name a second. I have to go to this magazine and figure out who's on the depth chart over here. But
well, and here's the thing. Just like I don't want DeSean Jackson on my team, I don't want any Minnesota Vikings wide receivers on my team either.
I have to give you an amen for that.
Yeah.
Give me an amen for that.
Sorry, Teddy Bridgewater. I just don't buy you, okay? I just don't.
Jarius Wright, Moritz Boehringer. These are some of the wide receivers on the squad. I mean, that's not good.
Boehringer, that's that German guy.
Yeah, yeah. He's one of those guys that had that interesting story, for those who remember on draft day, where like he didn't even play football until like past college or something. It's an interesting story. For sure. So, Sterling Shepard, the Giants guy, you're on the Eli Manning train, I guess. I don't know if you'll draft him, but with Odell Beckham over there, Victor Cruz, the tight end situation, you know, do you like Sterling Shepard? I mean, is it a lot of flair and this is not something we should take seriously?
I think you have to be responsible because, I mean, there is so much hype.
There's going to be drinking at the draft, right? I don't know how responsible these drafts are going to be.
I think he's being hyped pretty high right now.
Super high.
And I'm even though I am on the Eli Manning train, I want to be cautious about it, and I don't want to overreach for him being a rookie and me not having even seen a preseason game yet. So,
which is kind of true. I mean, we'll get to see a couple of preseason games before Sunday.
Yeah, I mean, right now I have him in round 9. And it would be hard for me to go any higher than that.
Okay. All right. I think, wow, that's tough just because I think Corey Coleman is the number one guy for sure. I think that's without a doubt. He's been getting good press as well. Sterling Shepard has Eli Manning. It's like, I mean, those are the two guys I look at more than anything. Kevin White, I don't know. I'd have to see some more. And he could shoot up. He's obviously very good. But those are the rookies. There's nothing I'm super excited about with rookies. There's not a great, super wonderful situation. And rookies don't typically have phenomenal seasons, really, either.
Odell Beckham did.
Well, he's Odell Beckham, right? Well, all right, we're going to continue on here. We've been going for a little while now, but that's okay. We're definitely in no rush here, and I'm sure all you guys want to hear everything that we want to do for the draft for sure and get some more knowledge. All right, let's get into the love, sleeper, bust category, and we'll start with the guys we love.
Now, I think that you're in love with him. What? That's ridiculous. No, I don't think so. You love him.
And Mikey is going to start off with Mike Evans. Now, Mike, you had Mike Evans last year. And, you know, one of my happy moments of life is watching football games with you. And, boy, did you bitch a lot about Mike Evans last year.
Tell me,
like, where you have him being drafted and maybe some guys around him, and why do you like Mike Evans so much?
So I have him in the second round, and I'm sure it was surprising to you that was the name that popped out of my mouth.
I did a double take for sure.
Yeah, because he was very frustrating with the drops. I just look at his frame. I look at his skill set. I look at the fact that Jameis Winston is going to be better in his second year. And it's not like he wasn't getting targets last year. He was getting targets. He just had bad luck with the drops. His touchdowns has really, really hurt his value. I think he only had four touchdowns.
Three.
So even less than that. I can see that number going up. I envision Mike Evans getting double-digit touchdowns.
He had 12 in his rookie year.
Exactly. That's where he should be. And so I think if he hits that number, and if his targets are close to 150, then I think that he's a cinch value in round two.
No worries about Vincent Jackson stealing. You kind of mentioned this on the previous show that you're not worried at all.
This is not 2008. I am not worried about Vincent Jackson.
How much do we believe in Jameis Winston, though? Do you believe... All right, now, Mike Evans had 147 targets last year. All right. I mean, we're talking about a guy... tell me where you have him ranked, but, you know, he's kind of elite, right? At least not the elite with, like, maybe the top three guys, but kind of in the next round, depending on where you have him, where you like him. But 147 targets is not a ton, and it's not... And he's not... Jameis Winston's never going to be a guy, at least in my opinion, that's going to be throwing 550 times, 600 times a year. He's going to be more in the 400, 450. He's going to run. Doug Martin's going to do his thing. I don't know. I mean, does that hurt? I mean, that kind of takes his value down if he's not going to get that many targets. But Winston was a rookie last year, so he could get more targets.
Yeah, second year in the dirt cutter system, I think that will help. I have Mike Evans just behind Brandon Marshall, but ahead of Keenan Allen.
Okay. I like that. Are you ready? I mean, you saw who I put, but Brandon Marshall. And I tried my best.
It's no secret.
I tried my best to, like, find someone else. In terms of value and where I think people are drafting him, and I know I had him on my team strong. I was trying to separate that as well. But, I have him sixth overall.
Yeah, I could dig it. I mean, you saw, if you watched any Jets game.
I felt it. Yeah. I not only saw, I felt, like, how great I felt with that late pick and how he did.
The relationship that Fitzpatrick has with Brandon Marshall is incredible. He looks for him on every single play almost. So, yeah, having him up that high, I mean, he's getting a little up there in years, but he hasn't shown that that's affecting him at all.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, I agree with you 100%, and that's why I had him – you know, ahead of Mike Evans. I think that's absolutely acceptable. I think he's going to have another big year.
I mean, I have him behind DeAndre Hopkins and in front of guys like Jordy Nelson and Dez Bryant, at least on my list. So many positive things. You mentioned 32 is not one. I mean, he's going to be 32 years old this year. Forte will take some passes away. But, man, 173 targets, 10 100-yard games. That is incredible. So to have 109 catches and 173 targets, he's durable, and it doesn't matter who his quarterback. I mean, he's had some pretty crappy quarterbacks.
He has.
Throughout his career, and he still puts up big numbers. So I hated to say it because I was like, I'm going to keep this one to myself, and maybe I can get him in the second round. You know, maybe I, depending on who's there, you know, for me, whether it be David Johnson or A.J. Green or something like that, and I go, maybe I get Brandon Johnson back, and I would just love life. But I don't know how that's going to – I don't know if it's going to happen, especially with Quain. I hate drafting next to Quain. I'm going to take – I'm just going to have that bottle of tequila right next to me because every time I'm going to guarantee 5 picks he takes away from me that I wanted and 1 pick away, and he's going to take it because Quain is that good, and that's why I'm worried he's going to take Brandon Marshall away from me. But that's a draft. You got to be ready, right? You got to be ready. Oh, it just drives me nuts. Right.
Yeah,
hate you, Quain.
I could see him doing it. I mean, Brandon Marshall, it's like you can pencil in, boom, 15 to 20 points.
Oh, my
Let's
gosh.
Take that on my week.
Like nothing,
pencil that in my lineup.
Nothing changes. Nothing changes for him other than Chris Ivory, and that's a good thing. So I didn't realize how much I was going to love Brandon Marshall until I went through my rankings. Like, I'll probably have him like 10th. I mean, compared to Jordy Nelson, who's still injury prone, and I see if I have it written down here, that he got hurt. He's still hurt in the preseason now. I don't have what he exactly is injured with. And then Dez Bryant, there's too many question marks. You know, and the guy I have right after that is Mike Evans. And after that, it's Allen Robinson. So, like, Brandon Marshall's got to be 6th. So I feel like I'm not going to get – I'm going to have to draft him or someone else at that point.
Yeah.
And I'm going to be okay with that. I think I'm going to be okay with that.
You think you are.
Well, you obviously have these scenarios in your head and what you wish. I mean, I have that turn, so I have 2 picks, so I draft again. And Quain, you know, I was like thrust my hand in the air because I'm so angry at him. He hasn't even done anything yet, but I know he will. Like you just have like, okay, this could happen, this could fall, and because maybe people don't. Like, I'm super high on Brandon Marshall, but maybe no one else is. Like, people think, oh, it's Brandon Marshall. He's older. He's not a first-round talent guy. So maybe I wait on him. And but Quain, let's steal him. But anyway, let's keep going here. Bust category, a guy you just can't stand.
Well, listen, you would be wise to keep your distance from him.
Why? He seems harmless.
Oh, he's not. He's very harmful. Really? Oh, trust me. He's a bad seed. He's a horrible seed. He's one of the worst seeds I've ever seen.
You have a guy that's coming off a major injury. He's going to an incredibly amazing offense. He had a phenomenal rookie year. But Kelvin Benjamin's not a guy you don't think is going to have a good year.
I don't. And I've just been seeing like some different mock drafts that I've been looking at where I've been seeing him come off the board like 5th round, 6th round, and which I just think is absolutely ridiculous. I think what a lot of people are looking at was that incredible rookie season that he had. And seeing that Carolina, you know, was this great offense and that because you're putting him into this great offense that he's just going to, you know, be even better, which I don't see that. I saw a change in Carolina's offense last year. You saw Cam Newton mature as a quarterback, and the reason why was he was spreading the ball around to all his different receivers, to the Ted Ginns, to the Philly Browns, to – you know, Greg Olsen, all these different guys. When Benjamin was having that great year, he was kind of like that, you know, guy that he had to go to, you know. So I think that if Carolina is going to succeed and still be, you know, at the top of the NFC like they were last year, I think it's going to be the same thing. I think Cam Newton's going to be spreading the ball around all these guys. And I think that includes Devin Funchess in there too. And so I don't think that Kelvin Benjamin is just going to be able to reach that 5th or 6th round. I have him more along the lines of 8 or 9.
Okay. Can you name me a guy that you have him pretty close to?
Yeah, actually, with Kelvin Benjamin, I have him right there with like the likes of Devontae Parker, who we talked about earlier. Kamar Aiken is another guy I have right around there.
Wow. All right, so we are definitely different. I have guys around him like Randall Cobb I have just ahead of him, in front of Jeremy Maclin, pretty close to T.Y. Hilton.
Yeah.
Wow. So yeah. My opinion of I have him ranked 19th. Obviously, the competition's there. You mentioned that. He's not 100% now.
he's not 100%. Reading something yesterday, he's been pretty quiet at camp. The only reason why they're even playing him possibly in this preseason game because it's a grass field. So, like, they're being very careful. They're going to slowly bring him back in the offense. But I'm going to tell you why you need to draft him sooner. Here's another trivia question for you, okay? We obviously know about his elite size. He has the number one. He has got speed to be a guy. We obviously saw his rookie year. For those who don't know his rookie year numbers, and it's important because that's part of the trivia question here, he had 73 catches, 1,008 yards, and 9 touchdowns. Now, since the NFL-AFL merger, he is one of two guys to put up those numbers as a rookie. Can you name the other guy? So in essence, what I'm saying is no other rookie ever in the history, well, I don't want to say the history, but the history of in terms when the NFL was one with the AFL, him and one other guy have only put up those type of numbers. At least 70 receptions, 1,000 yards, and 9 touchdowns.
I'm going to say T.O.
No, wrong. It's a guy you mentioned, who we've talked about on the show, yeah, happened in the same year.
So it's probably Odell Beckham.
There you go. That's why that's the caveat, is that he was the one. No one's ever done it since then, but he did it the same year as Odell Beckham. Just some other things from that. Only 8 rookie wide receivers had 70-plus receptions. Only 12 rookie wide receivers exceeded 1,000 yards, and only 12 rookie wide receivers scored at least 9 touchdowns. He did them all. So if he didn't get hurt, maybe he'd be up there in that top 4. Now, obviously, it's a little different if you want to compare him to those guys at the top for competition reasons, quarterback reasons. I you know how I feel about Cam Newton. At this point in time, I have him number 1. That could change. I'm kind of drifting towards the Drew Brees, putting him back in the number 1. But he's got a great quarterback. Kelvin Benjamin comes in. He's going to be the number 1 guy. I don't think Ted Ginn's that good. And it's not bad to have another guy, especially he's more of a speedster down the field anyway. Kelvin Benjamin's going to be more of the guy that's going to get the possession type of stuff. He's going to be looked for more in the red zone. Yeah, Cam will get some of his touchdowns in the red zone as well from the 1-yard line. But that is an incredible stat to me. If he did not get hurt, he could be in this conversation as a top 5 guy. I mean, Odell Beckham and Kelvin Benjamin. Like, he's 6'5", 245.
I'm not playing into
that. You're not.
That.
You don't like it? You don't like it? I can't sell you on it, Mike.
Not one bit.
Come on down. Hey, take a look at Kelvin Benjamin. He can help your team win a fantasy championship.
You,
Promise me.
I will promise you he'll get drafted way sooner than I have him. And I promise you.
Well, yeah, because I'm going to draft him way before you.
And I promise you I'll be happy with it because I won't have to have him on my team.
Let's do a board bet. Okay. I think Kelvin Benjamin, now I have him 19th now. And I could probably bring him up. I could like him better than T.Y. because I'm not a big fan of the Colts this year.
Oh, let's use that because I have T.Y. way higher than him.
Okay, so we want to do based on who has more points, MHA points in the end of the year, T.Y. Hilton or Kelvin Benjamin. So sure. I say Kelvin and you say T.Y.?
I'll take T.Y. Hilton.
Okay, there you go. So I think Kelvin will have more MHA points at the end of the year. Mike has T.Y. Hilton. So interesting. I saw that stat and I liked what he did and I was interested. And he got hurt before the draft last year. So I went to see where he was drafted. But he didn't get drafted because he got hurt before it all went down. So it scares me. It scares me that he's not 100% yet. Because, he got hurt before the season last year. Like, he should be okay, right? Jordy Nelson was before. And he seems to – and I don't know. Jordy Nelson is – he's got a setback injury. I don't know if Kelvin's had a setback. I haven't read anything about that. But be interesting to see. Okay. Keep on going here. My bust guy is going to be Demaryius Thomas, and we kind of talked about it already. I mean, I still think he could still have a good year. I don't think he's getting 100 catches. I think he'll be more in the 80 catches. His touchdowns will go back up to probably like 8. He'll be around 1,000 yards, maybe 900 to 1,000 yards. But based on where he's going to be drafted, I'm not going to get him. Like, I have him 16th now, behind Keenan Allen, in front of T.Y. Hilton. I could see Kelvin Benjamin jumping up there. But Demaryius Thomas, he's going to go probably early third round. And I think that's early. Now, I don't have an early third round pick. If he's there in the fourth when I take him, I guess I'd have to see how my team's coming together. But I don't know. I'm not a big fan, just like I wasn't last year at the beginning of the year. Like, I think he'll be okay, but he's not going to be elite. And I think he's going to be drafted
not as elite, but in that next tier of elite. And I think he's lower down than that.
Yeah, I mean, I don't necessarily disagree with you. I think he, yardage-wise, I think he'll still hit over 1,000 yards. I think he'll still hit that. His receptions may be down, though. I can definitely see that in a more run-oriented offense, which we spoke about. But I actually think that his touchdowns are going to go up. So, I mean, I kind of see him right around exactly the same where he was last year.
And where did he go last year? I mean, I could look that up.
Well, no, I'm not talking about within the draft, but I'm just saying statistically.
Just statistic points-wise? Okay.
Yeah, I think he'll make up for doesn't catch with probably a little bit of an increase with
touchdowns. But that's my problem with it, is that he's probably going to go higher in the draft than I'm going to take him.
Yeah.
And I think that hurts his value for sure. All right, so let's go to some sleeper guys.
I've always loathed the necessity of sleep. Like death, it puts even the most powerful men on their backs.
And that's when you bring in our lovely Frank Underwood spot. It's growing on me. Like, it wasn't my favorite things. I couldn't find anything to put there, but Frank Underwood's the man. I love Frank Underwood. If you guys haven't seen House of Cards, get your butt on Netflix and watch House of Cards.
We're not giving you any spoilers.
No, not at all. He has a lot of quotes. He loves talk. He likes breaking the fourth wall and talking to the audience, and it's just brilliant. I have to see who writes that show. I'm sure it's not Kevin Spacey, but boy, he sells it. I love it. Anyway, sleeper guy, another Benjamin for you.
It's all about the Benjamins.
It's all about the Benjamin with the Mikey. What is it? Travis Benjamin of San Diego. The big news out of that camp is Stevie Johnson just heard today that he is out for the season. That obviously he's smiling, nodding his head. That Mikey's smugness just pouring over into my section of the living room. What is it about Travis Benjamin other than what I just mentioned?
Well, that's Stevie Johnson being out is huge. What you're looking at with San Diego is a team that passes the ball a ton already. And they now have lost Stevie Johnson, Malcolm Floyd, and also Ladarius Green, which is almost 200 targets that they have to find some way to make up for. So you figure that some of those targets are going to go to Keenan Allen, obviously. You know, maybe Danny Woodhead.
If he stays healthy.
Yeah. Maybe even Danny Woodhead sees a little bit of an uptick, maybe. But I think that Benjamin is going to be the guy that really, really benefits from this. He's going to fill that kind of slot role that you saw Eddie Royal in a couple years ago. And if you look back 2 years ago and then 3 years ago with Eddie Royal, he had 8 and 7 touchdowns in those 2 years with San Diego. And he was right around 60 catches, close to 800-900 yards. And so I think for a guy that you're not seeing, you know, talked about a lot.
No, definitely not.
He's going to be one heck of a steal, at least in my book.
Yeah, currently he's second on the San Diego depth chart. And the only other guy really, Dontrell Inman is one of those guys on the depth chart. They didn't draft a single wide receiver. They did draft Hunter Henry, a tight end. But you know how tight ends in their first year never really pan out. You know, that's interesting. I mean, right now I have Travis Benjamin 50th, and that's as far as I went with rankings because I ran out of time and I needed to sleep and I had meetings to go to today. But that's interesting. I don't have anything really negative to say. I mean, I think I still don't believe in Melvin Gordon at this point, and I still hear he's not doing that well, so I have him really low in my running back rankings. So they're going to have to throw the ball. I still think it's going to be Keenan Allen first, Danny Woodhead second, and depending on what Travis Benjamin does this year, I mean, he had some moments of brilliance last year, and that was with Cleveland.
Well, yeah,
so it's hard to speculate, like, well, he didn't have that good of a year as a whole, but it was Cleveland at the same time. Yeah. I don't know. I guess
he showed that he's got some game-breaking ability to where he could take, you know, a little 7 to 10 yard slant pattern, turn up field, and be gone with it. So I think he gives that San Diego passing game something that they didn't have before. Something that if you put him in that role of Eddie Royal, he's like Eddie Royal except way quicker, more athletic. So, yeah, I just think he has a chance to really bust out and be fantastic this year.
Just looking at his stats, he's entering his fifth year, his first with San Diego, played with Cleveland his entire career. Did have 124 targets, 68 catches, almost 1,000 yards, but that's because his 14.2 yards per catch was incredible. 5 touchdowns. That's not bad. And I mean, it's pretty good considering the situation he was in. The previous years were just awful. 18 catches, 5 catches, 18 catches. 5 total touchdowns in the 3 years. So I mean, I see the risk there, but I can see your point, though.
Yeah, I think
I'm not going to disagree with you. I think I'm going to agree with you on that. I'll probably move him up on my rankings after this little conversation because I didn't think much about him either. I saw the Stevie Johnson. I was like, I wonder if Mikey knew this before. But, I mean that obviously helps him. And, I guess it depends on how many targets you think are going to be thrown out there. I mean, their defense is terrible, so they're going to have to throw. Their offensive line's not really good. They didn't do a ton to make that offensive line better. So, I mean, they got to go somewhere, right? So, Travis Benjamin, for sure. A guy that I have on my sleeper list is a guy that's a rookie. I didn't want to give him away in the rookie conversation earlier, but I like Tyler Boyd. Now, no one's really talking about him other than the fact that people are saying that he's been good in camp. I read a quote somewhere that said he's been king of the camp. With Tyler Boyd, he wasn't one of the top rookies drafted. But his situation screams, I think, to be able to come through and be one of those guys. I mean, who is the number 2 wide receiver in Cincinnati? If you guys didn't know who he played
Gio
for.
Bernard.
Technically in terms of targets, he can definitely be there for it. Let me get my Tyler Boyd notes. Okay, so he's being tabbed the star of the camp. Will mostly like be the number 1-2. We saw Cincinnati lose all those guys. And Sanu, Marvin Jones. He's been consistent in his Pittsburgh career and college. We mentioned the first year wide receiver. Usually those first year rookies don't put up big stats. He's also not a fast guy, which is one of the negatives. He ran the 40 at 4.58, so it's definitely not in the elite level. But, I mean, I don't think you have to be running at elite level to be able to make plays because, I mean, someone's got to be the number 2 in Cincinnati, right?
Are you telling me that you have very little faith in Brandon LaFell and Brandon Tate?
Well, I have no faith in Brandon Tate. I mean, Brandon LaFell played with Tom Brady. Tom Brady, one of the best quarterbacks of all times, and he couldn't get fantasy production out of him. And I think he'll right now LaFell's number 2, but I think if Boyd continues to do what he's doing in camp, no injuries, maybe he shows a little bit in preseason games, he could jump in as number 2, at least number 3 at the very least. But his situation screams better than some of those situations we've seen, like Laquon Treadwell. I'd take Boyd all day, even though he's being drafted higher, and so just because he had the better pub. Tyler Boyd wasn't a big-time stat guy. You know, in Pittsburgh, they ran the ball a lot over there. But, I mean, 6'2", 197 pounds, so he needs to bulk up a little bit to be able to muscle with those guys, with those corners and those safeties. But for a guy, I wanted to go deeper at wide receiver as a sleeper, and I think by the end of the year, he could kind of be up there. I mean, if I have to guess his numbers, if he got 50 catches, 700 yards, and 4 or 5 touchdowns for a guy that's not being drafted, I think it's pretty good. Yeah. That counts as a sleeper.
So, since he's your sleeper, I mean, do you consider taking him, I don't know, anywhere before like round 10, or is he just more somebody you're looking at towards the end part of the
draft? I guess it depends on how my team's coming together. If I feel like I have enough receivers and I need to draft more running backs, if I go really late on quarterback and I need to draft the second one, I think most of us do. We have pretty deep benches. So I think he's a guy I could take just so I look smart, that I pick him up. David Johnson was my guy last year. I love David Johnson, and I drafted him just about every league that I could in. And in our league, I dropped him because I ran out of bench spots, Chris Johnson was taking the lead. When he was on the field, it wasn't very much, but he was returning some kicks. He'd get a catch here and there and score a touchdown with it. But I just, I need to get some other guy. I don't remember the situation. That ended up screwing me at the end of it
sure
all.
Sure did.
Because if I would have had him, I probably would have won the championship, probably. But I don't know. It just depends. If I don't draft him, he's a guy I'm going to keep a real close eye on because it's going to take him a while. The speed of when the games count, it's a lot different than preseason. So it could take him 4 or 5 games. But if I see his catches start to ink up a little bit, I could see me, picking him up if, I have a guy that went injured or there's a guy I stopped trusting. Then, he's there. He's a guy I think can give you not spectacular numbers, but fantasy relevant numbers at the end of the year. And then maybe next year is when, you know, you draft him more as a third round guy, but more of a wide receiver three is probably the better word to use. Yeah. So Tyler Boyd, Cincinnati, I think he's a guy that can definitely help you out at the end. Any other receivers? Is there someone that we haven't talked about? We're almost at, I think we're a little past an hour. I think we started around 9, something like that. So is there someone that you wanted to talk about? That's someone that when you were doing your rankings, you're like, you know what? I think this guy, you know, can be something. This is a guy that I didn't think much about at first, but then now I really like him. You know, I don't know. We didn't really talk. Did I skip over the Colts wide receiver? I don't know if I put that on the list. The Colt wide receiver situation is interesting.
Yeah.
I am not a fan of the Colts this year. I don't have Andrew Luck that high. I'm going to be honest. I hated T.Y. Hilton before last night. I have him a little bit higher in my rankings after actually going through the stats.
Yeah.
But, like, a lot of people like Dante Moncrief, and I'm kind of one of those guys. And then you also have Philip Dorsett that are on some people's radar. So I don't know. What do you think about the Colts wide receiver situation?
Well, and you know from the quarterback podcast we did, I was one of the people that actually was really, really, really high on Andrew Luck.
Yeah.
So, you know, I like all those guys. I like Hilton. I had, Hilton, like I said, ranked right around there in the Jarvis Landry, Amari Cooper range. Moncrief I see as like a sixth-round guy, like right there with Julian Edelman, Larry Fitzgerald, guys like that. And I think Dorsett's draftable. He's somebody that you could take a flyer on in the 13th, 14th round, somewhere around there, because I think he's going to see targets too.
Well, the big knock against T.Y. Hilton, he's never been a big reception guy. You know, he had 69 last year. He's also not a big touchdown guy. See, I'm starting to see, this is the part I'm starting to hate about T.Y. Hilton. He has just 24 touchdowns in 4 seasons. Now, that's not terrible, but that's not elite either. And we're not drafting him in the elite range, but I think people see him as such. I mean, he was 25th in points. Fine, Andrew Luck wasn't there. But if he's that good of a receiver, he should be putting up better numbers, right?
It plays a big difference. Andrew Luck loves T.Y. Hilton. So we should throw
out Colts season last year? Just throw it out in the trash?
That's right.
No, because Andrew Luck was terrible even when he was in the game.
I
will say that Moncrief was better when Luck was in. I'll give you that. He had like 6, I have to go find him, the stat, but I think he had like 6 touchdowns when Luck was there and then faltered off because Matt Hasselbeck came in.
It matters.
But, I mean, I don't know. For T.Y., you know, I mean, his yards per catches are incredible. 16.4, 16.3 the last 3 years. But, I mean, he had 135 targets, so it's not up there either. But you figure that's because Dante Moncrief's going to get – he got some targets. If you're in love with Phillip Dorsett, tight end, help me out here.
Dwayne Allen,
he's going to get some as well. Frank Gore's not a big PPR machine anymore, but he'll get some. So that's a lot of people to have to try to
somebody's got to
make happy, you know?
Take Kobe Fleener's targets and the little bit of targets that Andre Johnson got last year.
Andre Johnson. We don't need to talk about him, right? Let's just continue on. I have Moncrief 27th. He has that more prototypical wide receiver build. Like I mentioned, he was incredible with Andrew Luck, but he had 9 games with 4 catches or less last year. 9 games. And I'm sure you're going to say, well, most of them were after Andrew Luck, which they probably were.
Yeah.
I'm not going to look that up. We're running out of time, but okay. But you're loving them, and I guess I'm not as loving them. Like, I'm not drafting Philip Dorsett. I hope I don't. I'll tell you, I'm drafting Tyler Boyd over Philip Dorsett.
Well, and like I mentioned this too in the quarterback podcast, with Chudzinski as the offensive coordinator now, I think they're going to be passing a lot more than they did
before. And that scares me. Because Andrew Luck loves to throw him some picks. He loves to fumble the ball. And I hear the offensive line is already having some injury problems. That's scary. I agree that he has the upside, but he had that 1 year. One year where he was fantastic. And everybody seems to think he can duplicate it. I still think he'd be top 10. I'm sure I don't have my quarterback ranking zombie, but yeah. I'm sure. Oh, because like, I mean, where did you have him? 2?
3? I had him top 5.
That's a little high. All right. Any other guys? Any other guys? Going through your list. I mean, we've covered a lot of wide receivers. for sure.
Yeah, I mean, I know a guy that you were on was Kamar Aiken, so maybe you want to talk about him.
You know, I don't have him as high. I kind of mentioned before what I had him. I have him ranked 39th, so right after those top two amazing, if you count them amazing, rookies, Byron Shepherd and Coleman, ahead of Josh Gordon, Sammy Coates. The more I just look at the Ravens' offense, just makes me just, ugh. You know, I don't. I mean, he's gonna be the number one guy, right? I mean, Steve Smith is still dealing with his injuries. You know, Joe Flacco, is he 100% back from his injury? Now he's a quarterback. He doesn't have to run as much, but he's still coming back from injury. That running game is so bad. I mean, I mentioned I love Kenneth Dixon, but it's going to take him time to get there. I mean, if I'm drafting a wide receiver, like, I don't have Steve Smith on my top 50. So I'm drafting Kamar Aiken at some point because I know he's got the PPR flair, but his touchdowns aren't going to be great.
I have to believe that Steve Smith is going to prove you wrong.
Man, I...
just because he's going to know that you badmouth.
And then I'm scared he's going to come over and beat me up, too. Yeah, he's a very emotional fellow. So Kamar Aiken, he's all right. He's all right. You know, I guess maybe I take him over the Sterling Shepherds and Corey Coleman's if I need more of a PPR guy, if I'm looking for a safer guy. But, I mean, you're not drafting safe guys at that point. You know, you're drafting for those upside guys that make you look smart and maybe end up being the best wide receiver on their team or the second best in a good situation like Sterling Shepard. So let's try to find one more. I mean, there's so many guys we could talk about. And I know we're up against the clock here. But
what about that mess in Tennessee?
No, I had nothing to do with it. I mean, DGB is the only guy. Like, I had him in the late 40s, 47th. Actually, I have Steve Smith 59th. And Philip Dorsett, 58th. So actually, I forgot, I went further down. But I have him 47th. Like, he's got that. Like I said a million times in this podcast, a prototypical build. He's got what you want in a wide receiver. I just don't know how mentally he's all right upstairs and taking it to the next level. I mean, I like Mariota. I said a lot of positive things on the quarterback podcast show. But just, can he put it together?
The one that you may want to look at that may actually even be better than Green Beckham, maybe Rishard Matthews. I'll just put that name out there.
Yeah, and he did some all right things in his previous place with Miami, right? So, I don't have Rishard Matthews, but I mean, someone will draft DGB just because of what he did last year. And if they think he's a breakout guy, he'll get drafted. But I've been hearing good things about Kendall Wright, but it's Kendall Wright
for years, and he's just kind of. Yeah.
He must be a really great preseason or a training camp guy. Because when he gets out in that field, man, you don't get much from him. I mean, Mariota's going to be better. I like Mariota. But are they going to let him just throw it 500 times in a season and make anybody relevant passing-wise? It would be, in my opinion, DGB. I don't know. It's interesting. Let me ask you about Amari Cooper. And then we're going to find some names for Venti, and then we'll go. Where do you have Amari Cooper, and is he overrated?
I have him in the third round, but at the end of the third round.
Okay.
I don't know that I want to call him overrated. He's only coming into his second year.
Yep.
So, you know, it's hard for me to call him overrated. Now, he had a really, really good beginning part of the year, and then he kind of tailed off a little bit. I think the concerning thing with him and with the Raiders in general? It's the red zone.
Yeah.
They have shown that Jack Del Rio prefers to run the ball in the red zone. So touchdowns would be the thing that if I'm an Amari Cooper owner that I'm going to be worried about.
You know, you should be worried about Michael Crabtree, too.
No, I'm not.
So now we're full circle. This is kind of how we started the podcast. I have him 36, but I mean, I probably just didn't move him up because I was so tired last night. But, you know, going through Michael Crabtree, and we don't want to forget about Amari Cooper and what he did. He obviously has a really great rapport with Derek Carr as well. They're coming up together so that you're going to have that affinity with someone that you've kind of, I know he came in a year later than Carr, but I mean, they're still really young guys. But I mean, for what Crabtree did last year, he had 146 targets, caught 85 for 922 and 9 touchdowns. He out-targeted Cooper last year. For all the talk that Cooper was getting, Crabtree was actually seeing more love from Derek Carr. Now, I mean, he's had 100 targets in 5 of his last 6 years. So that's some pretty good numbers, too. And the only year that he didn't have in that 6 years is because he only played 5 games. He was out for an injury.
So, I don't know. I feel could he get 9 touchdowns again? I wouldn't be surprised. I wouldn't be surprised. It's probably going to regress to more of like the 6 or 7. But if he's putting up 70 catches, 800 yards, and 6 or 7 touchdowns, I should shoot him way up 36.
Yeah.
And that diminished.
That would be you just believing that he's figured it
maybe,
out.
Maybe. Just but
like you're, midpoint of his career, all of a sudden the light bulb went off and he.
Well, I mean, if you're talking he's getting 100-plus targets, I mean, he's getting open. And maybe he's had some bad situations. You're talking about the teams he played for before. You know, I'm not saying he's fantastic, but I think he's a guy probably getting overlooked. I mean, we're not going to draft him because G is going to draft him.
That's true.
Because G, I mean.
I could see G like saying, fourth round.
G is taking Amari Cooper in the second round. I'm stamping it right now because that's where Amari Cooper is going to be at for him in the middle of second round, and then he'll get Crabtree in like the 5th.
I could see it.
And we're not going to even have a chance. I don't even know why we're talking about it, but I mean, for those owners who are interested, I think Michael Crabtree undervalued. I mean, he was 15th in points last year, and obviously it was those 9 touchdowns, but it'll be interesting to see where Cooper, if Cooper takes that step forward. So, I don't know. I'm interested. I'm trying to find Amari Cooper on my list here and where I have him. I kind of have him 12th behind Brandon Cooks, but ahead of Sammy Watkins, and that Watkins thing could change if he ends up being 100%. But he has a mediocre catch rate. He's dealing with a foot injury right now. So that's something to think about. Obviously, the lack of a running game will help him in targets, but then no running game means that he's going to get double teamed, and that'll leave things open for Michael Crabtree. So there you go. All right, those are the wide receiver talks. I have some names for Venti.
Okay.
I'm going to go through a couple. Some of them are dumb, I think. Some of them are funny. I was doing this at work, so I was trying not to laugh out loud while I was working because I had other people around me. All right, so here's some. He doesn't have like a favorite team. We were talking to Ryan last time before the show. I don't think we were talking about it on the show. So he doesn't have like a super favorite team. I looked at his team and it was so bad last year that I couldn't like pick a guy that was, you know, like he picked Demaryius Thomas. I'm not gonna make fun of Demaryius Thomas, but so I just looked up. I randomly looked for bad names. Okay, let's see. The Brady Bunch. He's got to hate Tom Brady, right? And we just find a stupid picture of Brady and. Something, I don't know. No one wants to be affiliated with Brady unless you're a New England fan, and he's not. So, okay, not liking it. Okay. Oh, wait, this goes back to Brady again. Brady soft balls. And we have a picture of, you know, I saw a picture of Brady as a baby with, you know, with the ball in his hand or something. Not digging it. You're not digging, okay? How about my dick in a box? Or my Vic in a box? Michael Vick. It's a little raunchy. My Vic in a box.
Okay. Well, I can dig it a little bit.
How about my ball Zach Hurts?
My ball Zach Hurts.
So it's more like my ball Zach Ertz.
Okay.
Not bad. The Big Tabowski, just because of what happened yesterday or 2 days ago with the whole Tebow thing, you know? So that's something. If he hates Tebow, I don't know if he's a Tebow fan, but if you hate him, then you don't want him as your team name.
Who isn't a Tebow fan?
Everybody in this apartment right now. You Sankey'd my battleship. I just thought that was funny, and I'm a dork, but I thought Bishop Sankey was terrible. You Sankey'd my battleship.
Yeah, I like that one too. I just he's not relevant.
Okay, yeah, agreed. He's not. You know, he knows what he's doing. Teenage Mutant Ninja Bortles. That's actually a funny, good one. I don't know. I mean, it's not demeaning by any stretch. Runs like a girly. We could say he plays fantasy football like a girly.
Yeah.
That's not terrible. Now I'm thinking about it. You know, we could say plays FF like a girly or plays like a girly.
Yeah.
Drafts like a girly. Oh, I think this is coming together. I come more Will Fork for money. So it's like Vince Wilfork. Will Fork for money. Or Will Fork for money. It's Will Fork for money. That's not great. Mikey's not laughing. Dirty Sanchez butt fumblers. You don't like Mark Sanchez. You do like Mark Sanchez. I don't know. He's kind of a Bronco fan, as we heard. And the last one I have is Romo Witten his pants. So that's kind of clever.
Yeah, that's
talks cool. about Romo Witten at the end of their careers. Romo Witten his pants.
Yeah.
So we have a couple okay options. We got to come up with a name. It's only a few days away from the draft, and I just went searching, and we just don't know Robbie as well as, like, I know you and come up with something that you'll hate and you'll just can't stand. Where Robbie, like, we don't know him that well. Like, we see him once, maybe twice. I mean, you may have seen him the other day.
Yeah, I did.
He was at the house, right? And I didn't make it over. But so we just don't know him that well. So it's hard to pick a name for him. So those are some of the names there. So
that's all the notes I have. The draft is only a few days away. 15 years. We're getting old.
We are. It's amazing.
But it's draft time. It's one of the days we love. We get to get together, drink, and draft. I haven't done my tight end rankings or my defense rankings, but how are you confident are you going into the draft? Scare the owners right now. How confident are you going into this draft?
I would say I'm more motivated.
That obviously the tough year last year.
I can smell trophy number 4.
Oh my goodness, really? You can smell. What's it smell like?
Smells great. I want to be. You don't know how bad.
I mean, is it like a French perfume? Is it new car smell? Is it a football, a baseball smell? Like, what does it smell like?
I can't explain it. It's so good.
It's not like a great pizza smell.
It's so good. I want to be the person to hit number 4 first, just because I know how much it'll kill you.
It would kill me. I'm glad you didn't repeat, because no one's ever repeated in our league. And for you to get number 4. But I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to tell the rest of the owners, I feel more confident at this draft than ever any draft ever. Because as much research as I had to do for the show, so I didn't sound like an idiot when I talked in front of you guys, like, I picked up a ton of stuff.
Well, and you're not even drafting next to Todd, and you're that confident.
Well, that's the only thing that scares me, is drafting next to Quain. And Quain, he's good. He's the defending champ, you know? And I feel like he's listening to all these podcasts 10 times over, so he knows what we like and what we don't like. So you're at the other end of the spectrum. You're way down at the beginning, so you have Robbie, you have Ryan, you know, obviously Quain has a track record compared to those guys, and I know he's, like, listening 3 times. He's right. He's taking notes. So he knows that Brandon Marshall, if I don't draft him, he's drafting him, because I'm not going to get him on the way back. That's how it is. But that's what makes it fun. I'm excited.
It's going to be great. That's going to ruin your whole night. You're going to have a whole 2 to 3 hours after that where you're just taking shots.
Listen.
Eric's going to be saying, I hate my team.
Listen to the podcast after we do the draft. How much I'm going to either really hate my team or how much I'm going to hate Quain. That's what's going to happen on this next draft. But we do have to go. MHA owners, we will see you Sunday. We appreciate you taking the time to listen out. We've had fun doing this. And so we're out here on the wide receiver edition of the MHA podcast. See you on Sunday.